good evening. It's good to be in the Lord's house. Appreciate you being out with us tonight. We're excited about this month. Each Sunday night we'll be having a different preacher with us for Fabulous February. Brother Joe is kicking off a meeting out of state tonight, so let's remember him in prayer, but we're excited about you being here. A whole lot of folks have asked us, and I've tried to put off making this announcement so I wouldn't say it a bunch of times, but we got to talk to Chuck, Miss Annie Mae's son, Chuck, this afternoon, and they did a MRI on Miss Annie Mae this morning at Piedmont Henry. They have found a spot on her brain that is putting pressure on the brain, and they want to do a biopsy, but they cannot right now because she is on blood thinner, so they're going to take her off the blood thinner for at least 5 to 7 days. They will move her to Piedmont, Atlanta later this week or toward the first of next week and do the biopsy. But we want to ask you, church, to pray for Annie Mae. I know for a lot of you, especially you Harvest members, she's very special. Annie Mae has worked the offices here for years, and she's very special to the staff. Not just because she brings biscuits and gravy, but Annie Mae is very special to us, and we love her. And I talked to preacher this afternoon, and Brother Joe said, "Brother Tom, y'all have prayer." And so what I want to do, we want to socially distance and do this right, but I want as many men that can to come fill the altars and up and down the aisles, and we want to have a word of prayer. We want to be in prayer for Brother Terry. Where's Brother Terry? Brother Terry will be having surgery in the morning, eye surgery. And then I called Brother Matt Everett this afternoon and was talking to him. And Brother Matt Everett, on the way out today, kind of missed the step down off the curb out here and has jarred his neck. And he's in a lot of pain. And, of course, right now he doesn't know what he may have done or how bad it might be, but he's in severe pain tonight. And so we want to go to the Lord and bear one another's burdens. That is fulfilling the law of Christ. And so where you are in your pews, where you are in your home, we're going to pray together for Sister Annie Mae. God will touch her, Brother Matt, Brother Terry, and I know there's others. I got to FaceTime Brother Tim Friday night. It was awesome. Miss Doris Miller came home Friday, praise the Lord. And we thank the Lord for answered prayer, but there are a lot of burdens, and we want to lift them up tonight. Brother Shane, would you come and take us to the Lord in prayer?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening. God, we thank you for the opportunity to be at your house once again. Thank you for gathering around. But God, we want to come to you, God, some with heavy hearts, Lord, that those have had loved ones that have already made crossings, God, those that are still in hospitals. Lord, I beg you, God, that right now that you would just touch them. I pray that you would lift them up, God. I pray that you would touch and give a hand of healing that needs to be touched. And we know that you are the great physician. And we beg you, God, that you'd give wisdom to doctors, nurses, those that are caring for those. And God, we right now especially lift up Sister Annie Mae to you right now. God, I pray that you would, Lord, go into that room, God, wrap her up. Lord, comfort her. Give a hand of healing upon her body, God, if it be your will. Lord, I pray that you would give the family peace and comfort, God, that passes all understanding. God, we beg you that you would just move a mighty miracle in her life. God, we know that you are able because we have seen and have witnessed miracles already. God, right now we just beg you that work another miracle. God, those are other pastors that are sick. God, I pray that you would touch them, Lord. I pray that you would touch Brother Matt right now. God, I pray that you would ease the pain. God, I pray that you would touch his body. God, I pray that you'd put a hedge of protection about them. Lord, those that are in pain, God, I pray you touch Brother Terry as he's going in for surgery tomorrow morning. God, I pray that you would lead, guide, direct everything and every move that is made by the hands of the doctors. Lord, I pray that you would just put your touch upon our service tonight, God. Lord, I pray that you'd touch the man of God, that you'd fill him with the Holy Spirit of God. God, I know, Lord, that we're here to worship you. And Lord, I pray that you would just fill our bodies, ourselves with, Lord, your Spirit. God, I pray that you would give comfort and a peace to those that need it right now, God. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. It's in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ that we pray all these things. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad that God hears and answers prayer? I'm so thankful that when I talk to God, that it's not just something that is out there and doesn't hear me, doesn't see me, can't touch me. But God, He is a God that does hear and hear us and touch us. But thank God we come to worship this evening. How many of you came to just worship God this evening? We're going to have a good time. I want to ask you to go ahead and stand if you will. How many of you feel like traveling on? Amen. We're going to get Brother Joseph come on around and lead us in this good song. Page number 133. Feel like traveling on, Brother Joseph?
My heavenly home is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Nor pain nor death can enter there. I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home.
Be seated. We're going to go right in and just worship God a little more in song. We're especially blessed here to have Miss Joanna is going to lead us and sing a song for us in a special. I'm so thankful for her, her testimony. You pray for her as she sings this evening. Come on, Joanna.
I'm too old, and I can't sing or teach, and no title do I hold. Lord, what can I do? For I want to do my part, and I want to help the hurting with all of my heart. I can pray now, until there's healing all around. That's something I can do. And I can pray in my secret place, calling on His name. That's something I can do. Oh, I can pray. lost and dying, and my words do not get through.
Awesome, awesome. We think that we can't do anything, but we can pray. We're going to make a few announcements real quickly. We're going to plan on doing an Impact Saturday, weather permitted, on February the 20th. So at 11 o'clock, if you'd like to be a part of that Impact Saturday, we'd love for you to come on and be a part of that on that Saturday morning. Weather permitting, we're going to have a good time. Now, that means that if it's cold, we're still going to do it, praise God. But if it's raining, we may not be able to pull that off. So just to have it be in mind and make sure that you want to, we want to make sure that we continue to grow. Reach out. Our pastor has already told us that if we're going to grow the church back, then it's going to be through soul winning. It's going to be through praying, and we can do our part here during that. Also, the Rochesters are going to be with us next Sunday morning, so make sure you come out, invite someone to be a part of that. We'll have a good time. And then real quickly, we made an announcement this morning right after service, and really kind of was everyone was going. But really what's happening, we want to, in realm, the system that we have, to be able to have a picture directory for us as the staff to be able to do that, and it makes it real simple. We're working on a way to be able to get these guys to take a big, pretty picture of you, smile. We don't want your photo like on the DMV, okay? So we want you to smile and have a good time. And we're just excited about that. And then on Wednesday morning, we are continuing on to do that service at 10:30. Had a wonderful time last Wednesday, and it's a blessing. So those of us that are not able to go, we are requiring you to use a mask. So wear the mask, and we're hand sanitizing, spreading everyone out on that Wednesday morning. But we'll have a wonderful time on that Wednesday morning. You come out and be a part of that. Amen. God bless everybody. We're going to get some other folks to sing here. They're over in the corner. Praise God. And I'll be honest with you, these are two of the meanest women you've ever met in your life. No, I'm joking. I'm joking. I'll pay for that. Sing on, children. Sing on. Pay for, praise God. But no, they're going to pray, sing a good song for us this evening. Amen.
You're singing too. So you need to repent between there and here. I'm just playing. You're in trouble now. Aren't you glad that before you even ask God for help, He's already got help on the way? You ever been there? Before you even knew you needed help, He's already sending whatever it is you're needing. And I'm glad that I know that whenever I call on Him, He's already got what I need headed my way. I just got to hang on till He gets it there. And I know this song will be a blessing to y'all tonight.
Woman in the Bible days, her last meal almost gone, but God sent Elijah to make His word known. He said, woman, don't you worry, for God sent me today. And before you even ask Him,
we have our next congregation, I'd like to make an announcement. We made short reference to it previously, but we're going to be doing the change offering for the children's home in Meduru. I believe I said that right, Dr. Harper. Meduru, India. It's on the location that we have the Harvest Baptist Tabernacle of India in.
Yes.
And what we done last year, what they have to do before they have their first day of school, they have to have a month's budget in advance. So what we tried to do last year was just help out with that. We said, well, if we get half of it, that'll be great. Well, we had 65% of it in 2 weeks. And after we spent a couple more weeks collecting money for this offering, we sent them $1,250. And so we far exceeded the budget. And so that was great. And we wanted to do it again this year. So we had it. We have it available now. So if you have change in your cars, your pockets, I don't care if it's a $100 bill, it'll all make pennies. We won't turn nothing away. And if you're listening online, you can send an offering to the church for the Indian Children's Home. Mark that, and we'll make sure that gets where it belongs, but just to try to reach these people. And this is the location here, the children's home. And if there's another picture to show up, it'll be Brother Samuel. He's the gentleman in charge of that mission over there, and they do a great job. They do a difficult job in a not an easy place to do missions, much less humanitarian and gospel missions in. But if you'd be able to bring us some of your change or some extra money that you have set aside from the other gifts that we have. And in the foyer also is some boxes left from Beams this morning. If you'll take one of those boxes in front of the bookstore, take it down to the post office, make a monetary sacrifice and get that shipped. They're going to Australia, Kenya, Uganda, Central and South America, sending Bibles to those who don't have any. But thank you for that. And this, you can remain seated. We're going to sing He's the Lily of the Valley, first and last verse.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing. Up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
You pray for Miss Lily. She's going to take us into the Word of God preaching time. And boy, thank God that we need to be faithful. Amen. Every step of the way. You pray for Miss Lily. She takes us in the preaching hour.
You know, Barry and I love to be with our children. We love to spend time with them. And I hope that when we're gone, they have wonderful, fun memories of Mom and Dad. But probably more than anything else, I want them to remember that their Mom and Dad loved Jesus with all their heart. And that they served him. And I want them to grow up and raise their children. Hopefully I get grandkids one day. That, you know, that the way to go is to serve Jesus. To love him with all your heart. Because there's nothing like it. So this song talks about finding us faithful to those generations that are coming behind us.
Thank you.
cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament of God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race, not only for us, but as those who've gone before us, may we leave to those behind us a heritage of faithfulness passed on.
Dreamed of being 51 and my boys being grown and looking back, Brother Buford, and thinking, man, I hope they see something in Daddy. But Brother John, that hits me a whole lot more today in the day that we live on being faithful to God. Our theme for this year from Brother Joe is B1 and 21. And if you pay attention to the sign that we try to change every couple of weeks and sometimes every few days, trying to put something down there, a faithful witness, a prayer warrior, on being faithful, being one in 21. And 1 Samuel 14 tonight, I want to preach, I asked Miss Lily to sing that, I want to preach a message on being a faithful soldier in this day. Seems like all around us, churches are falling by the wayside, men of God stepping down. I found out today a church in our area that's been around in existence for a long time, many, many faithful years, a church shut its doors this week. And it just, Brother Harper, it stirs within me to keep going, but it so burdens me, Brother Shane, that somebody didn't step up, keep a ministry going, keep a light shining. And boy, we need in this day, oh God, we need in this day for light to shine and for churches to be faithful, families to be faithful. And I was going through my devotions 2 weeks ago, and Brother Joe had talked to me. He said, we're going to kick off Fabulous February. He said, I've got 3 men lined up. He said, I feel like the Lord wants you to do the first Sunday. I said, okay, Brother Joe. And I began to study. I had a message in my heart 2 weeks ago, Brother Daniel. And then in my devotions, I got back in 1 Samuel. I love reading through the Kings, so I do a lot of reading through Samuel, Chronicles, and Kings. And I preached out of this passage to our teenagers about 7 years ago. Landon was in high school. And so most of the time, Brother Shane, when I read this passage, when I get to chapter 14 in my devotions, I usually run through it, because I preached it before. And to be honest, it's one of my favorite passages I've ever preached. So God, please anoint us tonight one more time. But the other day I was reading and I got to chapter 13 and the Holy Ghost said, now slow down. So I did. I slowed down. I read chapter 13 and then I got to 14 and I started reading, you know, and the Holy Ghost said, slow down. So I slowed down and read the chapter, and then the Holy Ghost began to work in my heart. It's like the Holy Ghost said to me, Brother Earl, now this is what you're going to preach. And I said, Lord, I preached that to the teens. And the Lord said, yeah, but I got something else for you. And I said, okay, Lord, if that's where you want us to go. So 1 Samuel 14 tonight, just trying to mind the Spirit of God. If you know your Bible and you've gone to Sunday school and you paid attention, you know that when you're in 1 Samuel, this is where the children of Israel have asked God for a king. And the Lord gave them what they wanted, not necessarily what they really wanted. Because the Lord said, okay, if you want a king over you like the rest of the nations, I'll give you one, but he's going to be a strong taskmaster and he's going to take your children and he's going to tax them and use them. And the Lord gave them what they wanted, but they found out it wasn't really what they wanted. And Saul is the first king of Israel. He's head and shoulders above all the rest of Israel. And Saul is reigning over Israel. And I guess because he was head and shoulders over Israel, he thought he could do what he so pleased. So when you get to 1 Samuel chapter 13, you find that Saul is down in Gilgal and he's waiting on the man of God, on the prophet Samuel, to come. And Saul gets impatient, so he calls for the men to bring him a sacrifice, and King Saul makes a sacrifice, which wasn't his duty, it wasn't his responsibility, it was for the man of God Samuel. And Saul makes this sacrifice and displeased the Lord greatly. And then you get over to chapter 15, and God has given Saul a command to go down and destroy the Amalekites, the king, the people, and all that's in the land of Amalek. And you know the story of chapter 15, how Saul goes down to Amalek, and Saul saved King Agag, brought back some of the cattle and the oxen and the sheep to sacrifice to God. Now we need to make a sacrifice, so you know, prophet, man of God, we brought back some sacrifices. And the prophet looked at Saul and said, the Lord likes obedience better than sacrifice. To behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. Chapter 13, he sacrifices to God and is not supposed to. Chapter 15, he disobeys God, does not follow through on God's command to destroy Amalek. And in the midst of two great failures, chapter 13, chapter 15, Dad has greatly messed up. In the midst of a dad, a father, a king, greatly missing God, Brother Shane, you have chapter 14 where we find a young man that decides to stand for God. a young man that decides, if daddy's going to mess up, I'm going to try my best not to. And you come to chapter 14, and honestly, this is one of my favorite passages in all the Old Testament. I love Daniel, I love Noah, I love David. I love studying David, but this chapter right here is one of my favorite passages in all the Bible. Because here's a young man that makes a choice and decides, I'm going to be a faithful soldier for the glory of God. And the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 14, now it came to pass upon a day that Jonathan, the son of Saul, said unto the young man that bare his armor, come and let us go over unto the Philistines' garrison that is on the other side. But he told not his father. And Saul tarried in the uttermost part of Gibeah under a pomegranate tree, which is in Migron. And the people that were with him were about 600 men. Now here's Saul. He's down there under a pomegranate tree, fellowshipping with his 600 men, and they're talking about the day, and they're enjoying the day. And Jonathan says to his armor bearer, hey man, we need to go up there to the Philistines. Now, if you read the last of chapter 13, you'll find out that this is pretty bold, and I'll get there in just a minute, because at the end of chapter 13, you find that Israel is facing the Philistines. The Philistines have come one more time against Israel. And the Philistines have taken every coppersmith out of Israel and have taken them. There's no smith in all of Israel. And the only people in all of Israel, read the end of chapter 13, the only people, Brother Earl, in all of Israel that have a sword is Saul and Jonathan. All the host of Israel is without a weapon. Maybe that's why Jonathan or Saul's sitting under the pomegranate tree. Maybe he's waiting for the smiths to come back. Maybe he's waiting for the day that they come back and make some swords. I'll just sit here and be patient and wait. We'll just sit down here while the Philistines are all around us. We'll just sit by and wait. We'll just see what's going to happen. Jonathan decides, man, I'm tired of waiting. Something's got to be done. These Philistines are defying God. They're making fun of Israel. They're making fun of God's people. Jonathan says to his armor bearer, come on, go with me. Come on and go with me. Verse number four. And between the passages by which Jonathan sought to go over into the Philistines' garrison, there was a sharp rock on the one side and a sharp rock on the other side. And the name of the one was Bozaz and the name of the other Sina. And let me say this, God does not put anything in the Bible without a purpose. Don't know how massive these stones were along the side of the way where Jonathan is going, but apparently they must have been pretty good size, because I've never known anybody to name a little pebble. There's two great stones in my mind. I see two great stones along the path, Brother Shane, and God puts the name of these stones in the Bible. We'll get there in a minute. Verse number six, and Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, come, let us go over into the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be, you'll find that phrase several times in the Bible. I'm going to preach on this one tonight. It may be that the Lord will work for us. I want to stop and tell Jonathan, there's no maybe to this, Jonathan. There is no maybe to God working for his people. It may be that the Lord will work for us, for there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few. Verse number eight, then said Jonathan, behold, we will pass over unto these men, and we will discover ourselves unto them. And if they say unto us, tarry until we come unto you, then we will stand still in our place, and we will not go unto them. But if they say thus, come up unto us, then we will go up, for the Lord hath delivered them into our hand, and this shall be a sign unto us. And both of them discovered themselves unto the garrison of the Philistines. And the Philistines said, behold, the Hebrews come forth out of the holes where they had hid themselves. Verse number 13, and Jonathan climbed up upon his hands and upon his feet, and his armor bearer after him. And they fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer slew after him. And the first slaughter which Jonathan and his armor bearer made was about 20 men. Within, as it were, a half acre of land which a yoke of oxen might plow. And there was trembling in the host, in the field, and among all the people, the garrison and the spoilers, they also trembled. And the earth quaked, so it was a very great trembling. Verse number 23, so the Lord saved Israel that day, and the battle passed over unto Bethaven. Here's a young man who decides in his day, I'm going to be a faithful soldier. There's an enemy out there and something's got to be done. I want you to get five things here tonight in this passage, and we'll hurry so some of y'all can go home and do what seems to be important to you and watch the NFL and that Super Bowl. And if you don't think things are back to normal, Tom Brady's in the Super Bowl, everything's normal. Five things about the life of Jonathan in this passage. Notice number one, the perception of Jonathan. The perception of Jonathan. Jonathan looks around and Jonathan says to his armor bearer, hey, I got to tell you something, man. There's an enemy out there that has to be faced. There's an enemy that must be faced. Now, this is a very common enemy to Israel. Israel had many. Study your Bible. You can go through them. You can name them. I'll not name them all, but you can go through the Bible. You know that Egypt was an enemy of Israel. They enslaved Israel. Egypt is a type of the world in the Bible. That's a picture of the world and our enslavement to the world. They had the enemy of the Edomites. The Edomites were the descendants of Esau, who sold out for pleasures for a little season, who sold his birthright out for a little pleasure, for a little safety. The Edomites are the ones that sold out. Then you had the Amalekites, who Saul was supposed to take care of in this next chapter, chapter 15, and the Amalekites were sorcerers and of witchcraft, and that's a spiritual picture of the devil and the forces of hell and the witchcraft that's against you and the forces of evil against you and me. Then you have Babylon, that place of bondage to the children of Israel when Israel failed God. And then in this passage we see the great enemy, the Philistines, which is a picture of the flesh. Israel had many enemies in that day, and Jonathan looks out and he realizes there's an enemy to fight. There's an enemy to face. And let me say to all of us, the worst enemy you'll face in your life is the devil and your flesh. You'll face the Philistines every day of your life. You'll battle with the Philistines in your mind. You'll battle with the Philistines in your heart, in your conscience. You will battle your flesh more than anything. Young people, listen to me. You better guard your heart. You better guard your mind. You'll battle that flesh more than anything in this world, because the devil knows you're a child of God. He knows you're a pearl of great price. He knows you're a jewel in the mind of God. And if he can destroy you and take you down with the flesh, he'll let the flesh of the Philistines destroy you and battle you. There's an enemy to face. Jonathan looked out and he said to his armor bearer, he said, hey, young man, there's an enemy out there to face, and somebody needs to stand up and face him. Somebody needs to stand up in the power of God and face the enemy. But he also saw there's an enemy to face, but he said there's an encampment that may not go with you. There's an encampment that may not stand with you and battle with you and fight with you. Where's daddy? Daddy's under the pomegranate tree, Brother John. Daddy's sitting down with his 600 men. Daddy's sitting by the wayside while Jonathan decides to stand. Hey, mom and dad, God help us not to let our kids outserve us. May those that come behind us find us faithful. May those that follow us know that we set a standard, that we set the path, that we stood in the way, we fought. But young people, listen to me. If mom and dad aren't going to stand, be somebody that stands. If the encampment won't stand with you in your school, stand. And let me say, whether it's public school or Christian school, hey, some of the Christian schools have a Christian name, but I know very well, I've been in them, Brother Shane, not all of them are Christian. And you may have to stand all by yourself. The encampment may not go with you. But if the encampment doesn't go, somebody decide that they're going to stand. The perception of Jonathan. There's an enemy to face. And you may face him all alone. You may stand in the battle all alone. But for the sake of the glory of God, stand. The Apostle Paul said in Ephesians chapter 6, and when you've done all, comma, to stand. There's an enemy to face. The encampment may not always go with you, but stand anyway. Stand for the cause of Christ. You say, but mom and dad won't bring me to church.
pick up somebody's cell phone and make a call. Mom and Dad ain't willing to come. They're going to sit at the house, but I want to go to the house of God. Call somebody. Hey, call Brother Tom. I got two boys that can drive. We got five vehicles sitting in the yard. Somebody can pick you up. And let me just say this. If you're not willing to just go pick somebody up, you need a love relationship with Jesus. You say, Brother Tom, you got too much going on. You can't afford to pick somebody. I can leave the house at 7 if you want to be ready. It is not beyond me, Brother Shane, to pick especially a young person that wants to come to the house of God. Somebody that wants to serve God, do right for God. Mom and Dad may not do right for God. Mom and Dad may not stand. And this isn't just for the teenagers and the young people tonight, but let me say to all of us, somebody stand. Somebody stand for the glory of God. And if the encampment don't go with you, hey, some of y'all work jobs that I can't even imagine. I don't face the world like you do. Some of y'all are out there on jobs. You're facing hell by the acre. But let me say to you, stand if the encampment don't stand with you. Keep standing for the glory of God. The perception of Jonathan, there's an enemy to face. And the encampment may not always stand with you. Number two, the persuasion of Jonathan. The persuasion of Jonathan. Now Jonathan looks at his armor bearer. He says, man, come on, go with me over here. We're going to go over into the garrison of the Philistines. And it may be that the Lord will fight for us. Oh man, if I could get in that old DeLorean and go back in time, hit them numbers and back in time, go back and see Jonathan. I'd like to say one more time, Jonathan, there's no maybe. Let me tell you, Jonathan, the Lord is for you. The Lord is for you. I don't think the Lord's much for your daddy right now, but the Lord is for you. And the Lord will stand for you. The Lord will stand beside you. He will not let you down. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here while I live by faith and do His blessed will. The Lord is for me. The Lord is with me. And Jonathan said, man, it may be that the Lord is for me, but it also can be that the Lord will use whosoever He wants. For there is no restraint in the Lord saving by many or by few. Where two or three are gathered in my name, behold, there I am in the midst. Did not the Lord send out the disciples two by two? It's not beyond the Lord to use one. He used one David to kill a Goliath. He used one Daniel to pray the power of God over the lions. He used one Paul to reach the world. He used one lad to feed 5,000 men plus women and children. It is not beyond the Lord to save by many or by few. Jonathan was persuaded. He didn't just have a perceptive heart. Jonathan had a persuaded soul and mind that the Lord is for me. The Lord is going to fight for me. And the Lord can save by me and you, man. The Lord can take the two of us and do a mighty work today. Jonathan didn't have some head knowledge. Jonathan didn't just have a knowledge of God and who He was. Jonathan had a heart assurance that God was going to do something through him. Because he's willing to stand. It may be. Listen to me tonight. It may be that in the year 2021, Brother Shane, it may be in the year 2021 that God might call one young man to be the next Jonathan Wesley, to go across this country, turn this nation upside down for the glory of God. It may be that God will take one in this day and start a revival. We had a young man in our school over in Covington in my brother's school. He got saved toward the end of the last school year back in April or May of last year. And his mom and dad are Mormons. I've told some of y'all about this. Back in December, this young man's mom and dad, this boy got saved, got in the Word of God. Brother Shane, this young boy, a senior in high school, got in the Word of God with a Mormon mom and daddy. Began sitting down with his mom and dad, Brother Don, at the house at night, taking the Bible and saying, Dad, here's what the book of Ephesians says. Paul said this, 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 this. And the Mormons say this, but Dad, this is what God's Word says. And the Mormons are wrong. Night after night, week after week, He's going to his mom and dad. Dad, this is what the Bible says. And the boy's studying his Bible, 17 years old. And back in December, Brother Don, I tell you, the devil's so vicious and mean. Back in December, this mom and dad walked in the office, in the school, Brother Daniel, walked in the office, looked at my brother and said, "You've brainwashed my kid. You've brainwashed our son. We're pulling him out. We're moving to Utah so we can put him into Mormon schools and they can get his mind right." And I sat there, Brother Daniel, and my brother called me, and I'm thinking about that, and I'm thinking, dear God, the devil's mean. The devil's vicious. Devil's trying to destroy this boy's life. Devil trying to mess up his mind again. And the Holy Ghost said, well, it may be that I want to put him out there and reach a bunch of Mormons in this last day. It is not beyond God to take one young 17-year-old boy, put him out in Utah, turn the power of God on his life, and let him see many of the Mormons set free by the grace of God. Because God can. God can. God can. It may be that the Lord, hallelujah, will fight for us. The persuasion of Jonathan. Number three, notice the persistence of Jonathan. The persistence of Jonathan. Now this gets me. The Bible says in verse number 6, in between the way where Jonathan is going to meet the Philistines, there are two great rocks. Now y'all get your mind with me. Come on, go with me. Jonathan's in the way with his armor bearer, Brother Shane. And along the path, there are two great stones. God had a purpose for him. I don't know all about it, but I know God had a purpose for them. And they had to be great, because nobody names a little stone unless you're a kid. But here's one great stone on one side of the path facing northward, and here's one stone on the other side of the path facing southward. And the name of the one was Bozaz, and the name of the other was Sina. You say, what does that mean, Brother Tom? Well, it'd do you good in your Bible to look things up sometimes. This one stone on this side named Bozaz means wet or slippery place. And this one on this side means full of thorns, a thorny place. And Jonathan was so persistent that he looked at his armor bearer and said, I don't care how wet it is, I don't care how thorny it is, I don't care how rough it is along the way, the land will not stop me. I'm not being stopped by something along my path. The devil's going to throw it at you. The devil's going to throw it in your way. But Jonathan said, I'm not being stopped. I don't care how rough it is. I don't care how thorny it is. I don't care how wet it is. I'm going to stand my ground. I'm going to get a sure footing, and I'm going to press on for the glory of God. The land is not going to stop me. Hey, would be to God that we'd get some folks today, young and old, that we'd find some saints of God, Brother Shane, that would be persistent and be faithful in this day, that would keep on going no matter what's around them, no matter what takes place, no matter how bad the devil fights you, that you decide to be persistent and faithful. Because let me remind you that only one time in the Bible, Brother Don, do you find the word success. Joshua 1:8, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt find thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. One time in the Bible, the word success, and it's all based and built upon this being a part of your life, hiding the word of God in your heart, letting God work in your life. But you will find 100 more times, 101 times, the word faithful in the Bible. Would to God that we get a generation, young and old, weak, strong, to say, I'm going to be persistent. I'm going to press on. And the land will not stop me. Because let me say to you, the land is against you. The devil is against you. You say, how bad is it, Brother Tom? Glory to God. Anybody felt like you've fought the devil all weekend? I got to preach chapel Friday morning at my brother's school. And I preached a message out of Matthew 13 on the pearl of great price. Gave the gospel. We had a young girl, senior girl, Friday morning in our school, trust Christ. I was almost to church, and my phone rings, and in my new Honda Accord, I got my phone plugged in, so you know the insurance doesn't know that I'm on my phone, so I'm hands-free, praise God, saving money. Hallelujah. State Farm is always there. And they are always there. And my cell phone rings, and I see it on my little display right there, and I'm thinking, I don't know that number. And very hesitantly, I answered, hit that answer button. I said, hello? And this little girl, this voice come across, preacher, oh. I said, yeah. This is Morgan. Morgan at the school. I said, hey, Morgan. I just wanted to call and tell you I just trusted Jesus Christ. I about wrecked my car, Brother Don. Woo! I come in, I was a shouting. Shane goes, man, what's going on? I told Shane, I said, man, just had a senior girl got saved. I preached the gospel. God saved her life. Woo! Oh, man, I was thrilled about it, Miss Janet. Hallelujah. The devil wasn't thrilled about it. He hadn't been thrilled about it all weekend. It seemed like I fought hell by the acre, Brother Earl, all weekend. Got ready to come to church this morning. I got my mind on this message. I got my mind on the music. I got my mind on worshiping God. And those of y'all that know me, my mama's a good mama. She makes Sunday dinner every Sunday, Miss Janice. And this week, we were going to take the vegetables. And my wife had done the vegetables. I went in there and got them. And foolish me didn't put them in a basket, you know, being smart. I'm taking them out to the van. I'm holding them, trying to open the van door. And all of a sudden, Spencer goes, Dad, you're spilling carrot juice all over your suit. And bless God, I done told the family, we are leaving at this time, be in the van, we're not going to be late. And glory to God, I run in the house, slam the door. Beth goes, what's wrong with you? I said, that lid you put on them vegetables was leaking. Well, it was quiet on the way to church for a little while. And I looked back at my boys and I said, somebody tell the devil where to go today. Somebody tell him I don't want to talk to him. I don't want to see him. I want to tell you, if you're going to be persistent and stand for the glory of God and not let the land stop you, the devil will do everything he wants to fight you. But decide you're going to be faithful. The land will not stop me. And then Jonathan said, the labor is not too strong. The labor is not too strenuous. Now, what did the Bible say of Jonathan and his armor bearer? You get over to verse 13, and the Bible says, and Jonathan climbed up on his hands and feet. Now, let's get with this. All you guys that have served, Jonathan didn't have fatigues. He didn't have army boots. All he had was that skirt, whatever they wore. God bless them. A skirt and some sandals. And I don't know, Brother Earl, how high the hill was. And I don't know how rocky it was. I don't know how wet or how thorny it was along that way. But Jonathan said, the land's not going to stop me, and the labor is not too strenuous. I can go on. If it means crawling on my hands and on my feet to get to the enemy, to face the ones that are against us, the labor is not too strenuous. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. The perception, the persuasion, the persistence of Jonathan. But then notice the poise of Jonathan. The poise of Jonathan. Jonathan looks at his armor bearer and he says, hey man. I like this word in the Bible. Boy, I like this word in the Bible. Hey, friend, we're going to go over there and we're going to discover ourselves unto them. So, Brother Tom, what does that mean? It means in common redneck Georgia language, he said, hey, boys, y'all been laughing at my daddy? Y'all been making fun of my God? Y'all been cursing our land? You've been cursing my God, and I'm just here to tell you, I've had enough of you, man. We gonna get it on. I am here to let you know that God's on my side. You say, what's that word poise mean? Jonathan was a bold man. Jonathan wasn't a sissy. Jonathan wasn't weak. Jonathan said, we're going to go over there and discover ourselves unto them. Now, if I had been Jonathan's armor bearer, I'd have said, hold on a minute, man. Your daddy's got a sword and you got a sword and I got not a thing. We're going to do what? I said, we're going to discover ourselves unto them. We're going to let them know who we are and why we're coming and in whose name we're coming and who's on our side. And it's going to be so good. I'll tell you how bold I am. I'll tell you how bold I am. Young man, listen to me. I'll tell you how bold I am. If they say come up here, God's going to give us a victory. God's given us a sign. Jonathan went by, and I have no doubt. Y'all say it didn't happen that way. That's fine. When you get to heaven, you can watch the video on God's big screen out of the cloud. God's going to put it on the cloud, and everybody get to watch it. If you don't have Wi-Fi and understand what the cloud is, it's past the DVDs today, okay? DVDs are no longer. It's all on the cloud. God's going to pop it up there, and y'all going to see. Brother John, I think that boy John stood up, John, and he said, just come by to tell you who's on my side and whose name I'm coming in. And I'm just going to tell you, God is for me. And if God be for me, who can be against me? The perception of Jonathan. There's an enemy to face, and the encampment may not always go, but press on, keep going. The persuasion of Jonathan, the land will not stop me. The labor is not too strenuous. The persistence of Jonathan, the boldness, the poise of Jonathan. Now get this. Look at the power of Jehovah. The power of Jehovah. I thought you was preaching on Jonathan. I am, but he served somebody. And it wasn't Jonathan's power that won that day. It's the power of an Almighty that saw a faithful and a true soldier and it came through. Now notice down there in verse number 13, and Jonathan climbed up upon his hands and upon his feet and his armor bearer after him, and they fell before Jonathan and his armor bearer slew after him. And that first slaughter which Jonathan and his armor bearer made was about 20 men within half an acre of land. You say, how big is that? Oh, about the size of that basketball court over yonder in that gymnasium, Family Life Center. A little 50 by 100 piece of land. And when we get to heaven, I'm going to get to see this one on the cloud. There goes Jonathan, Brother John, and his armor bearer. Now, I don't know which one had the sword. I don't know who had the shield. And maybe somewhere along the way, the armor bearer picked up a stick. But within a little basketball court, Brother Wade, they went to town. And the Bible says that they slew 20 in the first slaughter. The first slaughter. They slew 20. Now, I'm not going to read it. Some of y'all want to go home. But that Bible there in 1 Samuel 14 says that it stirred up a noise. And the Philistines got so overwhelmed by it. Glory to God, Brother Daniel. They got so overwhelmed by it that they began to beat one another. They began to chase one another. God confounded them. God messed up their mind. And the Bible says, and the Lord saved Israel that day. You say, what's your point, Brother Tom? My point is, somebody, today, young or old, I don't care who you are, somebody needs to decide to be a faithful soldier and say, the land will not stop me. The labor is not too strenuous. There's still an enemy to fight. And let me remind you, get this. Oh, God, help us to get this. Your enemy is not a Republican Party. It's not a Democratic Party. It's not the government up in Washington. That is not our enemy, Brother Shane. Our enemy is still a roaring lion who is walking about seeking whom he may devour. Your enemy is not the neighbor you work with that you think is against you. Sure, they're full of hell. Sure, they're full of the devil. Sure, they curse you every day. But that is not your enemy. That is a soul that God died for. And God wants you to be a good soldier, a faithful soldier, and to stand and say, hey man, you're not my enemy. but there's one that's against both of us, and he wants your life just as much as he wanted mine. But God set me free, and in the good grace of God, he can set you free. God's looking for somebody today that'll be persuaded that God is real, God is powerful, God will not let you down. It may be, yes it is, altogether in full assurance, God will fight for you and me in this day. So God help us in this day to be faithful soldiers. Well, I've messed up and turned off that thing, so I'll give it to you the best I know. Some of y'all are going to turn me off right here, but if you'll just stay with me, maybe we can help you. Washington Roebling. Anybody know that name? Washington Roebling in the 1800s was a great architect and builder. His father was a great architect. Washington Roebling was the main contractor, constructor of the Brooklyn Bridge. But before he ever got there, Washington Roebling served with the Union forces in the Civil War. Don't turn me off, Joseph. And you should all thank God that the Union won and we're still one United States of America. Praise God, South arise again. Washington Roebling was a Union soldier, served under a great general. And at Gettysburg in July, on a hot summer day, Washington's regiment come to the hill of Little Round Top at Gettysburg. And the story of his life says that Washington Roebling was the first man to the top of Little Round Top Hill at Gettysburg. Now, if you study history like Joseph does and like Landon does, then you know that Little Round Top was the turning point of the Civil War. Washington Roebling was the first one to the top of the hill. And the stories and the records that I read of his life said that from the top of the hill, Washington Roebling could see the eyeballs of the Confederate soldiers in the trees. And Washington Roebling, the first one to the top of the hill, let the general know where they were and where the attack was coming from. And on that day, the Union Army, yes, the Union Army stopped the Confederate Army, the turning of the war at Gettysburg. And the Union Army, you know, won Gettysburg, and took over, and that led to the end of the Civil War. And thank God we're still one nation under God. But Washington Roebling was asked, just a few days after the great Civil War, Washington Roebling was interviewed. And a young man asked him, "Shane, can you tell me about your great exploits at Little Round Top?" And Washington Roebling said, quote, "There's nothing to be said about running up that little hill. But there is much to say about standing and not being killed. There's nothing to be said about running up the little hill. But there's much to be said about standing and not being killed. Would to God, Brother Shane, some soldiers of the cross would decide that it's more than just running up a little hill. It's time today to stand, Brother John, and not die in the battle. Stand your ground. Be a soldier of the cross. Be faithful and true. Don't back down and don't let up. Be a faithful soldier in 21. This may be our last year. This may be our last chance. So be a good soldier of the cross. And when you've done all, stand for the glory of God. Father, we love you. Oh God, I thank you for one opportunity to preach the truth of the Word of God one more time. I thank you, Lamb of God, that you've called us out. You set us free. Lord, though we don't deserve it, Lord, we never deserved a great gift of salvation, but you sought us and you bought us. What a high price you paid for us. God, may we determine in this last day, young and old, wherever we are, God, we're going to be a faithful soldier to the end. We're going to stand on the battlefield and be faithful and true till the trumpet sounds, till Jesus comes. May we be found standing in our soldier boots, being true to the cross, being true to the call, being committed, Lord, to the family. Lord, may we never back down or let up. Oh, God, help us to be a great soldier. Thank you, Lord, for your good, mighty work in our life. Thank you for the touch of God tonight. Oh, God, stir something within us that would fire us up to be true to the end. God, I want to thank you for every good and perfect gift, every great treasure you've given to us. God, you've been real good to this young man. God, you should have killed us a long time ago, but I thank you, Lord, for leaving us in the battle. May we be true. May your people, God, find the strength and the courage to press on, to be a Jonathan. Because there's no doubt about it, God, it's not just a maybe. God, in full assurance, we know tonight that God is for us. No one can stand against us. May the power of God rest on us. And we ask it in the lovely, holy name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Boy, that's good, babe. Let's stand. We'll close out singing that. Stand up.